not Hug.
Redemption.
Well, welcome everybody. Congratulations, Jim. That's an accomplishment. So a little bit about myself. My sobriety date is May 30th, 2016, which puts me a little bit over 8 years of sobriety. More importantly, I have a recovery date of 18 months later when I found the program in November. So I was sober when I got here, so that's a little bit different of that story, but I'll get into that. So I'm married, I have a wife of 18 years now, two kids, 15 and 12, two cats, a dog, and three chickens. We got a little Ronald McDonald farm, so. But yeah, so... When did I become an alcoholic? Probably very early in my drinking stages. I was alcoholically drinking. I drank to black out. I didn't socially drink very often. And if I did, I really was upset that I had to stop drinking. But yeah, so things got pretty bad right as my senior year of high school. I wasn't doing well in school. I was drinking all the time. It was a party for the whole senior year. And I just wrote it off as, you know, kids being kids and just didn't think too much of it. I went to college for a little while and that was the same thing. It was just a party and I ended up dropping out of school. The whole last semester, I knew I wasn't going to go back, so I just partied every night before I had to go to the real world and get a real job. So that didn't do me any good there either. And I always kind of, in the back of my mind, knew at those times that I was drinking too much. And I didn't know what blackout drinking was until I was at a bachelor party in Florida, and the bartender was like, "You're going to black out tonight." And I'm like, "What does that mean?" Like, "You're going to wake up and not remember what that means, or not remember what you did." And I said, "Doesn't everybody do that?" And she kind of gave me a look, and I'm like, well, you know, and I woke up in the morning, didn't remember the whole thing other than what she had said, and woke up on a pool table. That was not a very good night's sleep. So, yeah. But I always wrote it off as just having fun and, you know, I wasn't hurting anybody. I wasn't doing anything wrong. I drank and drove a lot. Fortunately, I never got caught, and I never hurt anybody, more importantly, that I know of. I did flip my truck, and that I was drinking the next night. I had my best friend and my favorite cousin, or my best friend cousin, whatever you want to say, in the truck, and we flipped it over and drove away, went home. Well, we called somebody, pulled the truck over, got it out of the ditch and parked it, and then drove home and acted like nothing happened. The stupid shit I did, and I didn't realize what I was doing was actually hurting people. And it probably started with my parents first. I didn't know I was hurting them. I was just drinking all the time. And then I got married, and I would say I was better when I was married than I was when I was just dating my wife, but it was still blackout drinking when I drank. I wasn't a daily drinker, but I was a blackout drinker when I drank. And it just continually got worse and worse and worse. I was starting to switch to hard liquor, so I could hide it more. And I was a terrible liar about how much I drank, because my wife would always ask when I came home, and, "Oh, I had two or six," and she's like, "You can barely stand up." And, you know, and I had a high tolerance for, and so I could drink a lot of beer, and, you know, but I just drank as fast as I could to get to the drunkest point that I could. And that's just how I was. And So that, I mean, I could go through all the drinking stories of how bad it was, and, you know, all the mean things I did, and, you know, all that kind of stuff. But for me, more importantly, it was finding my way into here. You know, and one other thing that I just remembered that I wanted to say. So I was sober, and me and my wife were not getting along. We were progressively fighting more and more. At first, when I first got sober, how I got sober was I drank too much, and I woke up around the toilet from a conference at a casino for one of my businesses, and one of our suppliers just kept buying us shots and drinks, and I don't even remember how, it was in Columbus, and I don't remember how we got home, I don't remember anything out, but I just remember waking up in the bathroom, and that was in February, and by the grace of God, my wife went to the church, and she was really upset, and she was sitting in adoration, and the priest just happened to walk up to her and asked her if she was okay, and she said, no, my husband's drinking all the time, and the priest said, have you heard of a program called Al-Anon? And she had not. So she went, she actually went to her, went to an AA meeting before I did. And so she started Al-Anon in February of 2016. And so that February, I'm like, okay, I'm never drinking again after that night. And I was doing real good. And we were getting along much better. And then Memorial Day came, and I kept telling myself, oh, you know, you can drink again, you can drink again. You know, and I started with the church wine. I'll just start there. And then it was Memorial Day weekend, and I went out with my buddies on Saturday, Friday. I don't remember what night it was, and I got blackout drunk again, and then she was really upset because I had told her I wasn't going to drink again back in February. And so I'm like, I got it under control this time. And she was really pissed. And so we went out with my sister the next day, or Monday or Sunday. I think it was Sunday. And I had one drink there. And then the following Monday, which was Memorial Day, I was folding laundry, and the show Addiction was on, and it said, you're not truly sober unless you go sober for 1 year. So I waited for her to come home, and I said, I watched this show, and I'm going to stay sober for 1 year just to prove that I can be a sober person. And so that date would have been May 30th, 2017, and that was the only date I could think of in my mind, was that I was be able to drink again on that date. So, at first, like I said, at first, and she knew better because she was an Al-Anon, so she knows all the principles and steps and all that stuff, so you can't get away with anything. That's kind of the way I put it. But I progressively became more and more of a dry drunk. And it was, at first it was great, and then it was getting worse and worse, and I was like, things were really falling apart pretty quick. My businesses were failing, we started to not get along altogether, my kids were not engaged with me at all, and I just turned my obsession to drinking into my obsession with work. I would just stay at work for hours and hours on end because I knew if I had an idle mind, I would probably go out and drink. And so I consumed myself with something else, and that just kept leading me down that dry drunk stage. So we were getting ready to go visit my sister, and we weren't getting along, so she's like, would you like to listen to the AA book, the big book? And I said, you know, maybe it'll make her shut up for a little bit. Like, all right, I'll listen to it. So I put it in my ear and just drove. And we stopped for gas, and I just drove. And it was about 10-hour drive, If you ever listen to it on the book, it's about 8 to 10 hours. So I got through the whole book on the drive. Get there, she's like, did you relate to anything? Not a damn thing.
No.
And in the back of my mind, I'm like, this is the autobiography of my life. It depicts everything that I went through, everything that I'm going through. But I wasn't at my bottom point at that point when I was, you know, driving that day. It was me having to admit that I was an alcoholic that made things get better. So I don't even remember when that was, but eventually I made it to my first AA meeting. And how I got there was, she called me. I was sitting at work because I was always at work at that time. And she called me. She said, I'm going to the church to figure out how to get our marriage annulled. And she was still in Al-Anon. I said, what if I go to an AA meeting? She's like, well, I'll consider it. She still figured out how to get the marriage annulled, but so far she has not annulled the marriage or divorced me in any means. But so I put it off for about a week. There's a beginner meeting in Salina. I'm like, I can't go all the way over there. That's too far away. There was Friday night in Coldwater where she was going to Al-Anon. I'm like, well, she's got friends there. I don't want to mess with that. And I just kept putting it off, and then she just gave me a look, and then it was Black Friday, day after Thanksgiving, and there's a meeting in New Bremen, which is where I'm from, so I figure, well, you know, it is what it is, I'll just go there. Being that there's day after holiday, I thought, well, maybe I'll get out of this because they don't have meetings on holidays or something like that. But come to find out, no matter what, if the meeting's on Monday and it's Christmas, the meeting's still on Monday. So if you don't have an excuse to not make a meeting for a holiday, there's always a meeting and they're all over online too. So, but I walked up to the first door and yeah, there was a new meeting in Bremen, and there's a double door, and it was locked. I'm like, oh, sweet. we all know our friend Ray. He was walking in, and I said, is there an AA meeting? He's like, yeah, you got to go through that door right there. Okay. And I walked in, and some of you were there that day, and I walked in, and I just kind of spilled all kinds of things that were going in through my mind and how I got there. And, you know, I thought of all the alcoholic things I did, and everybody was so welcoming and kind of turned into a little bit of a lead and a little bit of shares. And I just, when I left there, I knew I was in the right place. And I called my wife immediately. I said, you know, I'm in the right place. You know, this is what I need to do, to find the help. And she was, I don't know. She wasn't jumping for joy or anything. She was very, didn't trust me at all. So I said, I'll just keep going there until things turn around. And they gave me a big book, and I physically read the big book for the first book that I've ever read since probably the eighth grade. And that probably pertains why I dropped out of school. And I read it, and I read through the steps, and I asked a lot of questions. They tell you sometimes to shut up in the first couple meetings you're at. But I asked a lot of questions about the steps, and I asked a lot of questions. And I got a lot of good answers from a lot of good people at the meetings. And then there were some days I just shut up and took what I needed from the meeting and left the rest, is a phrase that I like to think works. And then it was when I said, Jason, alcoholic, that I realized things were going to get better because the people here understand me. People here know what I'm going through, and I can just be myself at a meeting. And I can share a problem that I'm having, and I can get tons of feedback, or, you know, and if I don't want to hear the feedback, I just leave it at the meeting. I don't take it home with me. And it was the right place. And since then I've been coming to a lot of meetings. I try to make one, at least one a week, if not two. In the winter I go every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday when I'm not plowing snow. So meeting makers make it, stuff like that. And then a unique situation happened. You know, you're supposed to help another alcoholic. And come to find out, my brother was alcoholically drinking. And I knew he drank, and I knew he drank like me, but I didn't know he was becoming a daily drinker. And he was down in Florida. He tried the geographical change, went from Columbus to Florida to try to, you know, change things about himself and his life. And we were down there the summer, and he didn't drink the one day, and he got so sunburned, he stayed home the next day. Well, he drank the next day, and I could smell it on him, like, well, whatever. He got sunburned, he just had a couple beers by himself, whatever, while we were gone. And he didn't let me go into his garage. I thought that was weird. And so about 3 months later, he starts texting the family that he's in the hospital. He had the ambulance come get him from work. The doctor said he's got a heart of an 80-year-old man, and the whole family was starting to freak out, like, what the hell is going on here? Come to find out, he was drunk and he was making this up. He did have a panic attack at work and he went home. So we come to find out, and he was so embarrassed about it. But fortunately, my sister was actually in Florida at Walt Disney World with her daughter. And so she went to my brother's house, and she opened the door, and there's the whole house full of beer bottles. And that's why he wouldn't let me in his garage, because the whole garage was full of all his drinking. And so my sister didn't know what to do, and we're like, we'll check him into rehab or something like that. And he wouldn't go. And so we sent my dad down there, and I told my dad, I said, whatever you do, get him to an AA meeting. And if he doesn't like the first one he goes to, take him to another one. And take him to another one until he finds one he likes. And so this was me helping another alcoholic. But I knew I couldn't be a sponsor because of the family. And and he called me right before he went to the AA meeting, just drunk all of his mind. He's like, you gotta help me. I said, Dad's on his way down there. The only thing I'm gonna tell you to do is go to an AA meeting and listen, and things will get better. And he went to the first one, he didn't like it. He went to the second one, he liked it, and so far he's been sober for over 2 years now. And he's the secretary, and he leads meetings, and he's being a part of it. So that was, it was eye-opening that, you know, it's a family disease, and it affects everyone in the family, you know, and maybe I could have been a better example for him when he was younger. He wouldn't have drank so much, but, you know, that is what it is. And so just happy that the program helped a family member, and it's continuing to help a family member. It's strange, but he had maybe a girlfriend here and there, and, you know, the rule is you're not supposed to date anybody for a year, and so he didn't, and then he found this girl online, and they got engaged within 6 months, or even less than that. And I was worried at first that, you know, because she wasn't part of AA, she wasn't an Al-Anon, would she understand that he can't drink? And so I asked him, I said, are you still going to meetings? You know, are you still, you know, taking care of yourself? He's like, yeah, I handed her the big book. I said, if you want to know anything about me, just read this book. Well, at least you're honest. So we're going down there. In November, he's getting married. So we're going down there. And it's a pretty cool thing that what the program has done for our family and helped him out. So, you know, and then it was weird. We were talking about that same thing on Friday at the meeting about helping another alcoholic, and Joe texted me, do you want to give a lead on Sunday? I said, well, I guess it probably meant to be, so I probably should. And I haven't been over here in a while. But just saying I'm an alcoholic and relating to other alcoholics makes my life easier and simpler. It's a softer way. And I'm just so grateful for this program. I'm grateful for the Al-Anon program. Because if it wasn't for that, I probably wouldn't have made it. And if it wasn't for this program, I know I wouldn't have made it. There's just so much good that happens here if you keep coming back. And I got great friends in the program. We have a lot of fun before the meetings, after the meetings, Kevin's party. You know, you make friends with these people and you get to know these people and you get to be a part of their lives. And you know what they're going through. I am going through a little medical scare right now with myself. And I share it at meetings and I get feedback. And biggest thing is to not Google what your problems are. Wait for the doctor to tell you. But the doctors aren't telling me fast enough and Google will tell me within a couple seconds. And so, but I got an appointment coming up September 19th, so it should help me put me at ease of what's going on. But I know I don't have to drink over it, and I know that's not going to help. I'm just grateful because that's the first thing I did when I found out what my numbers were so high. I went to a meeting that day and I said, I think I'm going to die. And it was a big meeting on a noon meeting, and everyone's like, oh, well, you know, and you relate to people, and then he's like, I have cancer, and I've been cancer-free for so long, and well, I was sick, and some alcoholics shared that their liver was shutting down, and because of they drank so much, and mine's not because I drank so much, it's just something that I'm going through, and so, you know, it eased my mind that day. So then I was good for a little while, and then the doctor called, and I can finally get an appointment. She's like, well, your numbers are really high. We'll give you the first available appointment, and that was December 11th. I'm like, that's the first available? You're going to make me wait that long? She's like, I'll put you at the top of the wait list because of your numbers. And I said, okay. And then she called back the same day and said, someone called September 19th. I'm like, oh, thank God. Because I started praying, like, I don't want someone else to not have the appointment so that I could have mine. And I was praying all day, and sure enough, she called me back within like 3 hours. And so then I called my wife, and then I was scared that day. So I went to the meeting again, and I said, I got all this going on. Still think I'm going to die, but I think I'm okay with it. And I've always said I'm not afraid to die. It's just the fact of leaving. And the more and more I thought about it, I got scared again when she said, we need to get you in immediately, as soon as you can. And I got scared again that day, and then I just started praying about it to my higher power. And the next day I came to the realization that there are a lot more sick people, and there's a lot of little kids that are sick, that they don't make it as well. And, you know, I started to think, I've lived a good life, and I've had 8 years of sobriety life. You know, I don't think I'm going to die. But I've lived a good life, and I've changed my life to be a better person, much better than I'd ever could have done without the program. And the program made me realize that. For one, if I was drinking still, I probably would have a lot more health problems than what this is. And I probably would have never got it checked out. I'd just like, whatever, I don't care what this is. I'll just, you know, keep drinking, and whatever it is, it is. And but I got it checked out, and I started treatment for part of it. And so I find out September 19th that what it truly is going to do for me, I guess. So, yeah. So that's part of the program, gets you through just life events, and it's not even a drinking event. It helped me get through being scared, and it helped me many a times before too get through, you know, times when I thought about drinking or times when I thought about suicide. You can call people, you can text people. Problems with my wife, you know, I can bring that up in the meeting. It doesn't have to be all about being a drunk. It's all about being part of life. It's just great. I can't explain it enough how grateful it is. You know, and the first lead I gave was, you know, all I did was talk about the drunkenness that I did. And that, it was very early in my recovery, and now all I want to talk about is the recovery part. You know, just how grateful it is to have all that. So, just thankful for all you guys here. Just keep coming back. I don't know what else to say about how good the program can be. You know, that's where I'm at with it. So, I thank you for having me. And with that, I'll probably pass.
Thanks, dude.
Jay Alcoholic. Thanks, Jason.
Yep.
When I first drank, I was all right. But when I really started drinking, I blacked out. And I thought that was the coolest thing. You know, I did something, woke up, and drink again, and blacked out. And I was staying with my mom and dad, and they finally had enough and just ready to kick me out the door. And so I didn't drink as much, but I didn't pass out, but I still was drinking to the limit. And finally, one of those blackouts, just somebody called me and said, I did this, and I'm like, shit. But that call is what I needed, and I'm just blessed today, and anybody else like to comment?
Thanks,
Joe.
My name is Tom. I'm
Hi, Tom.
And I remember, I think it was probably your first meeting, I don't know, but when you came in, you looked like you were just lost, well, you know, your shoulders were down, and now you're seeing people, you're helping. I mean, you helped somebody got 2 years of sobriety now.
Yeah.
Really. You helped your brother. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
And that's only because of God. That's only because of prayer. And that was really a good story. I'm glad I got it.
Thanks.
I'm Andrew, recovering alcoholic. I want to thank you for coming over and sharing with us. It just means a lot to me to listen to these stories. And something that I went through, and I just thank you for being here.
Thanks, Andrew.
No, not
at all. Hi,
God. Yeah, I can relate to your story quite a bit. I used to be the same way.
Yeah.
I drank from time I got up, passed out, turned my back around, hit. If it wouldn't have been for the law getting me before PDI, I'd probably not be here tonight. And I'm glad to be here. Thanks.
Thanks, Tom.
My name is Wes. I'm an alcoholic.
Wes.
That was great. Yeah. Straight. Unadorned truth. And that's what we come to hear. What's your truth? And that's we just point it out. And can't do better. So I'm glad I was here. There's power in each of our stories. And, no matter how far down the scale, they're still going to benefit somebody else when they tell you the story. No matter if it wasn't that far, no matter if it was really, really far, it doesn't matter. There's value in all of our stories. We usually don't realize that until somebody else hears it and says that. That's all. That's all I got. Thanks.
Thanks, Wes.
Thanks, Wes.
Go, John.
Steve, Jason, thanks for your story. You really tell it how it is. And you know, you mentioned finding the answers in the big book. And that's all of our commonality.
Jason, so great to see you.
Thanks for coming all the way over and telling your story. I appreciate it. Always enjoy it. Nice to see you. Anyway, so it's funny about, you know, when we were leaving this house, I remember my early days too, and some of the stories were, you know, about how we got it.
Yeah.
And I look back, it was just kind of meander without, I mean, it just didn't really have any purpose. It was just one drunk to the next, all together, a bunch of these stories.
Yeah.
And then, with some time, we can start to tell about our sober time, what it's like now. And there's, you know, there's an order, there's a purpose with it. There's, we see the progression, we can talk about the progression. There's a timeline involved. It's a big change from how I lived my life in the old days to how I live my life today. It's pretty cool. And for helping your brother, man, who knew?
Yeah.
Who knew that our stories would have died? And really, unless we use our story to help somebody else, then we're just guys that screwed up their life once upon a time. You know? So that was a big shock to me when I found that out. And it just made me want to serve more. And it's the third of our program, right? It's supposed to be Recovery Union Service. For the health care, nice to put our faith at the test, I guess.
Yeah.
You get to do that. It's nice to see when I. It's nice to see myself when I have that knee-jerk reaction as the best person. So for, it's faith. And I'm realizing our mortality. It's nice to know that we have the opportunity to somehow even tip the scale back the other way. Right? I feel so much of my life really self-centered, self-driven. It's all about selfish. Now it gives us a chance to tip it back the other way, more service oriented, think about a fellow man, whatever. It gives us a chance to even score. And I always say, Gary T is a miracle with that man. He was an alcoholic. Mm-hmm. For the 6 years he tore up, Cold Water, Ohio.
Yeah.
But it's been a blessing to the entire community for 50 years since.
And
I'm not going to have 50 years to. In the mind of us, but it's nice to have a chance, and it's nice to think that looks good. So, thanks for coming over tonight. It was good to see you.
Thanks,
Jim.
And Joey, I'm an alcoholic. Hey, so I've kind of seen you on this journey, and it's so good to see you tonight and to hear you. Because I think I was there that first meeting that you came to. And wow, from your last lead I heard to this one, just amazing. And so, 7 years ago, I had a little bit, I had some stuff going on, and of course, Google, whatever, I self-diagnosed immediately, and then went straight to planning my funeral.
Yeah.
So, you can see, I didn't need to do that, but, and I think at that moment I came to the realization too that what a miracle it was that I wasn't going to leave behind this horrible thing, legacy to my children, which we come to these places in our life and we will, we're like, oh, we're not going to be here forever. I get to turn 60, right? My son said, how you doing with that, Mom? You ever start thinking about your mom and dad dying when you were out? It's like, come, Luke, But, that's reality. But what a great feeling it is that this program's allowed me to make my amends, to go on. And we're both going to live to be 80, so it don't much matter. But it is, because I would have left this horrible mess behind me.
Yeah.
And today, I got to be present in the people's lives that I've loved for 14 years now. I've got to show up. I've got to be there. And I'm going to keep doing that just like you are. And I think we get these little scares just to put life in perspective sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
And that's okay because I got this higher power that got to me today. And I didn't believe that before I came to these rooms. And to know we can turn that kind of stuff over and then just go on and live one day at a time, like and when you were trying to put things into words, how do you put into words that this room saved our lives? This, yeah. You know, but everybody in here understands that. There wasn't probably one of us sitting there going, I know, you can't put that into words. You can't put that into words. But what we can do is do exactly what you're doing, give back to another alcoholic. And by standing up here tonight, that's what you did. And you told a great story that, you know, has a purpose today, and it's not just your messed up, screwed up life. It's this story that can save another life. And, yeah. So I'm really glad about your brother. That is so cool, because I know we had talked about that, and wow, yeah. Because that's a miracle right there when you have two people in recovery in your family and they're both making it. You know, our odds aren't that great. I mean, look at that. That's just, that's God, and that's awesome. So, yeah, Jason, I'm so glad you came over tonight, and I haven't seen you in a while, and I just, not that you ain't there. Haven't hit the same meetings, but it's so neat to see you, and I'm so happy for your family today.
Thank you.
So I'll pass. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jerry. I'm Sandra. I'm an alcoholic.
Hi, Sandra.
Thanks for your lead, Jason. I think I met you at the New Bremen meeting a couple of times, but I really didn't know much about you, and I always enjoy getting to learn more about people that I see in the rooms, you know what I mean? You're not just a name, you know, so I like that. And I mean, giving back to an alcoholic is definitely a gift, but when especially one you love, you know, and it's a family member, that's even a greater gift, I believe. I have one of my family members in the program, and that makes me feel, that makes my heart smile even that much more. You know, it makes me feel that much better. Even though, I mean, it's just helping another, you know, alcoholic is a plus, but, and I'm sorry to hear about your test. I'll pray for you and your family. But Google, the only thing Google's for is good for is to get you where you need to go and not what you need to know. You know, that's something I learned. That's all that, you know, if it ain't Google Map, I don't Google. But, I'm glad to hear you talking about it came tonight, and I'm glad to get to know you more, and good luck on the 19th.
Thank you.
That'll pass.
Thanks, Miss Sandra.
Is there anybody out there on the phone that'd like to comment? Okay. We'll end the meeting with the board. Hello.
Hi, Sharon. This is every alcoholic.
Hi, Sharon.
Hello. Hey. Congratulations, Jim. That's awesome. And Jason, man, that was a great lead. You know, you've come a long, long way. And like others have said, to be able to help your brother, what a blessing. What a true blessing that is. So, wonderful lead. Thank you so much. Keep coming back.
Thanks, Sharon.
All right, let's close this meeting with our Father.
Yeah, no problem.
help me open this mini with a serenity prayer. God.
God.
Gracious and kind, to us that good things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and wisdom to know their difference.
The AA preamble. Alcoholics Anonymous is a fellowship of people who share their experience, strength, and hope with each other that they may solve their common problem and help others to recover from alcoholism. The only requirement for membership is a desire to stop drinking. There are no dues or fees for AA membership. We are self-supporting through our own contribution. AA is not allied with any sect, denomination, politics, organization, or institution. Does not wish to engage in any controversy, neither endorses nor opposes any causes. Our primary purpose is to stay sober and help other alcoholics to achieve sobriety. And I asked a friend to please read how it works.
I'm Sandra, I'm an alcoholic.
Thank you, Sandra.
How it works, rarely have we seen a person fail who has thoroughly followed their path. Those who do not recover are people who cannot or will not completely give themselves to this simple program. Usually men and women who are constitutionally incapable of being honest with themselves. They are such unfortunates. They are not a fault. They seem to be born that way. They are naturally incapable of grasping and developing a manner of living which demands your rigorous honesty. Their chances are less than average. There are those, too, who suffer from grave emotional and mental disorders, but many of them do recover if they have the capability to be honest. Our stories disclose in a general way what we used to be like, what happened, and what we are like now. If you have decided you want what we have and are willing to go to any length to get it, then you are ready to take certain steps. As some of these we thought we could find an easier, softer way, but we could not. With all the earnestness at our command, we beg of you to be fearless and thorough from the very start. And some of us have tried to hold on to our old ideals, and the result is nil until we let go absolutely. Remember that we deal with alcohol, cunning, baffling, powerful. Without help, it is too much for us. But there is one who has all power, that one is God, and we can find him now. Half measures failed us nothing. We stood at the turning point. We asked his protection and care with complete abandon. Here are the steps we took, which are suggested as a program of recovery. One, we admitted we were powerless over alcohol, their lives became unmanageable. Two, came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. Three, made a decision to turn our will and our lives over to the care of God as we understood him. Four, made searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. Five, admitted to God, to ourselves, and to another human being the exact nature of our wrongs. Six, we were entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of character. Seven, humbly asked him to remove our shortcomings. Eight, made a list of all persons we had harmed and became willing to make amends to them all. Nine, made direct amends to such people wherever possible, except of when to do so would injure them or others. 10. Continued to take personal inventory and when we're wrong, promptly admitted it. 11. Sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God as we understood him, praying only for the knowledge of his will for us and the power to carry that out. As a result of these steps, we try to carry this message to alcoholics and practice these principles in all our affairs. Many of us exclaim, what an order. I can't go through with it. Do not be discouraged. No one among us has been able to maintain anything like perfect adherence to these principles. We are not saints. The point is that we are willing to grow along spiritual lines. The principles we have set down are guidelines to progress. We think spiritual progress rather than spiritual perfection. Our description of the alcoholic and the character to the agnostic in our own. In our personal adventures before and after came clarity regarding the ideals. A, that we were alcoholics and could not manage our own lives. B, that probably no human power could relieve our alcoholism. And C, that God could and would give us help.
Thanks,
Sandra.
Thanks,
can I ask another friend to please read Thomas's?
John Wayne, alcoholic.
Hi, John.
The AA promises, one, if we are painstaking about this phase of our development, we will be amazed before we are halfway through. Two, we are going to know a new freedom and new happiness. Three, we will not regret the past nor wish to shut the door on it. Four, we will comprehend the word serenity and we will know peace. Five, no matter how far down the scale we've gone, we will see how our experience can benefit others. Six, that feeling of usefulness and self-pity will disappear. Seven, we lose interest in selfish things and gain interest in our fellows. Eight, self-seeking will slip away. Nine, our whole attitude and outlook upon life will change. 10, fear of people and economic insecurity will leave us. 11, we will intuitively know how to handle situations which used to baffle us. 12, we will suddenly realize that God is doing for us what we could not do for ourselves. Are these extravagant promises? They are being fulfilled among us, some quickly, some slowly. They will always materialize if we work for them.
Thanks, Charles. Can I ask another kind of misery together questions?
I'm Andrew, recovering alcoholic.
Hi, Andrew.
September the 8th, we ask His protection. We ask His protection and care with complete advantage. Alcoholics Anonymous, page 59. I could not manage my life alone. I had tried that road and failed. My ultimate sin dragged me down to the lowest level. I had never reached and unable even to function. I accepted the fact that I desperately needed help. I stopped fighting and surrendered entirely to God. Only then did I start growing. God forgave me. A higher power had to have saved me because the doctors doubted that I would survive. I have forgiven myself now and I enjoy a freedom I had never before experienced. I've opened my heart and mind to Him. The more I learn, the less I know. A humbling fact, but I sincerely want to keep growing. I enjoy serenity, but only when I enter my life totally to God. Also, as long as I am honest with myself and ask for His help, I can maintain His rewarding experience. Just for today, I strive to live His will for me soberly. I thank God that today I can choose not to drink. Today, life is beautiful.
Thanks, Andrew.
Thanks,
and I ask another friend to please read the 24 hours.
Tom Alcoholic.
Hi, Tom.
September 8th, A thought for today. Another motto of AA is for the grace of God. Once we have fully accepted the program, we become humble and become humble about our achievement. Yes. We do not take too much credit for our sobriety. When we see other suffering alcoholics in the throes of alcoholism, we say to ourselves, but for the grace of God, there go I. We do not forget the kind of people we were. We remember those we left behind us, and we are very grateful for the grace of God which has given us another chance. Am I truly grateful for the truth, trace, the grace of God, meditation for the day. A consciousness of God's presence as one who loves you makes all life different. The consciousness of God's love promotes the opening of your whole being to God. It brings wonderful relief from the cares and worries of your daily life. Relief begins peace, and peace brings contentment. Try to walk in God's love. You will have that peace which passes all understanding and contentment that no one can take from you. Feel sure that God's unfailing love and care for you and for all his children. There is freedom and serenity in those who walk in God's love, held safe in his arm, loving care. Prayer for the day, I pray that I may walk in God's love. I pray that I may go as I go. I may feel the spring of God's power in my steps and the joy of his love in my heart.
Thanks.
Bill Caesar. Perfect humility. For myself, I try to seek out the truest definition of humility that I can. This will not be the perfect definition because I shall always be imperfect. At this writing, I would choose one like this. Absolute humility would consist of a state of complete freedom from myself, freedom from all the claims that my defects of character now lay so heavily upon me. Perfect humility would be full willingness in all times and places to find and to do the will of God. When I meditate upon such a vision, I need not be dismayed because I shall never attain it, nor need I swell with presumption that one of these days its virtues shall all be mine. I only need to dwell on the vision itself, letting it grow and evermore fill my heart. This done, I can compare it with my last taken personal inventory. Then I get a sane and healthy idea of where I stand on the highway to humility. I see that my journey toward God has scarce begun. As I thus get down to my right size and stature, my self-concern and importance become amusing. That's it.
Thanks.
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 Would somebody like to give out tokens? Or I can.
Go ahead. Hey, my name's Tom. I'm an alcoholic. Here at Fort Cover, we got a token system here to know the greatest length of sobriety. First token is a beginner's token or a 24-hour token. Does anyone need a 24-hour token? How about 1 month? 2 months?
We just do three.
All 3, 6, 9.
Oh, okay. Okay, anybody need those? How about a year? Any year after?
Jim, I'm not calling.
Hey, Jim.
11 years was Mark.
All right. All right.
I'm good. Congratulations,
Jim. And we all got today.
Joe, I'll call it. And there's loose leaf literature on that table back there. It's free. The meeting schedules are also up there, and they're free. And the books that are up there will be at the cost that the group pays for them. Okay, announcements. I have Coldwater 43rd anniversary, Sunday, October 13th, at the Holy Trinity Catholic Church in Coldwater. 1 o'clock, the doors open. Bring a friend and a covered dish. 1:30, eat, chicken provided. And 2:30, Leeds, A.A. Leo K. Anzona, Ohio, and Al-Anon Lori S. from Hartford City, Indiana. Maybe if I can get this apart. And then we also have September 28th, Kevin's annual fall bash. Chili and brats will be provided. Bring a side snack or dessert to share. And don't forget your lawn chair, please. You can ride anytime after 4, and we'll eat at 5:30 or 6. And then there's a new meeting, Friends of Bob and Dorothy, an AA meeting for LGBTQ and allies. It's a leader sober, open discussion meeting. Monday, 7 p.m. at Greenville, Ohio. Anybody have anything else? Okay. I'll pass the seven tradition basket. Okay, I'd like to introduce ourselves. Joe Alcoholic, could you please provide who's on the phone, please? Anybody out there?
I'm Sharon. Yeah, I'm Sharon, recovering alcoholic.
Hey, Sharon.
Anybody else? Okay, we'll start with who's here. Go ahead, Sandra.
I'm Sandra, I'm alcoholic.
Thank you, Sandra.
Steve, alcoholic.
Hey, Steve.
John, alcoholic.
John.
Will, alcoholic.
Hello.
Jim, alcoholic.
Hi, Jim. I'm Jimmy, I'm alcoholic.
Hey, Jim.
Tom, alcoholic.
Hi, Tom.
Andrew, recovering alcoholic.
Hi, Andrew.
Doug.
Hi, Don.
My name's Wes, I'm alcoholic.
Hi, Wes.
Jason, alcoholic.
Hi, Jason.
Okay, at this meeting, we have a leader discussion. Tonight, we are fortunate to have a gentleman to give his lead. I met him in New Bremen when he first came in, and then with COVID and everything, I really didn't see him much. But I looked forward to what he has to say. Jason, could you please